Blackstone presents Runaway, Notes on the Myths That Made Me by Erin Keane. This book is read by Erin Keane. For my mother and my brother, and for Megan and Alexis. Chapter 1. She's a Bright Girl. Of all the lies I once believed about my mother and father, the biggest was the one I told myself. For most of my life, I reveled in my origin story as a daughter of the grittier downtown version of Woody Allen's Manhattan, a movie I loved fiercely, perhaps because it, too, demanded a certain amount of self-deception. In 1972, my mother was 15 years old, a beautiful runaway from a respected military family, living as an adult under a fake name in New York's East Village, when she met my father at Googie's, her favorite bar. They fell in love and married that year. He was a recovering heroin addict, sporadically employed and with a criminal past, a self-taught, bullshitting Renaissance man who drove a cab and wooed her with barstool poems. He was also the same age as her father. Googie's is where I thought my family's story started. When he was 36 and nobody knew, or more likely, nobody cared, that my mother was a child, claiming to be in her 20s with a name and a backstory that had nothing to do with being the daughter of an army officer and a mother in bespoke beaded dresses who saw cotillion and college in her daughter's future, not hitchhiking across the country, sleeping in subway stations, hanging around bars with penniless actors and artists, drinking for cheap. After all, in Manhattan, we don't see what 17-year-old Tracy was doing before she starts dating Isaac, the twice-divorced protagonist who is her father's age and who cracks self-conscious jokes about it in front of his friends. We're not actually supposed to care. A girl becomes visible to the world, stories like Manhattan taught me, when a man appears next to her in the frame. It is embarrassing now to admit how much I believed in Manhattan and for how long it remained one of my favorite films. And yet, I know I'm not alone. A movie doesn't become a perennial best of without a certain cultural consensus behind it. See the 2007 critical outcry from New York Magazine after the doddering American Film Institute dropped Manhattan from their best 100 films list. The magazine protested that the movie is an absolutely perfect film, one of the few that 100, 200 years from now, they'll still be watching, list or not. Call me impressionable, but 2007 was the year I started my own career as a culture writer, and I gave a lot of weight to what New York's critics wrote. That same consensus has long positioned men's narratives as the world's de facto serious stories, even when the fictions they contained were wildly self-indulgent. After Allen's adopted daughter Dylan refused to stay silent as an adult about her allegations that he molested her when she was a child, the cultural consensus now about Woody Allen is, to quote actor Wallace Shawn's defense of him, that he is a pariah. As a supporter of survivors of abuse and exploitation, I have no appetite for his work anymore. But I can't pretend I never did. If you had asked me 10 years ago if I thought there was anything wrong with the relationship Allen wrote for his stand-in Isaac and the teenaged Tracy, a role that garnered Mariel Hemingway an Academy Award nomination, I would have waved away the question with a non-committal shrug. To make great art, we must create space and empathy for characters who make bad choices, right? And that grace we extend to fiction has long bled over to include the art's makers and their misdeeds. At long last, that's beginning to change. Prominent men in numerous industries have been exposed, denounced, and diminished over their exploitations of power, including with teenage girls. Headlines treat those men as powerful outliers. But I don't believe they're special. Their choices were formed by a culture that romanticizes men who have big appetites that shape their allure and cause their downfall, all while casting aside the unruly girls left in their wake as damaged goods. I am also of that culture, a product shaped by it. My father, the complicated seeker, my mother, his beautiful life raft. I never questioned their marriage's power imbalance, how it tilted everything in his favor.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.